Welcome back. This lecture explores the law surrounding compelled decryption. Imagine that Alice stashes her files in a notebook computer. That's fairly common. And Alice has encrypted the computer's hard drive such that it's indistinguishable from random bits. The police show up and they seize Alice's computer. They're frustrated to discover, though, that they can't access the hard drive's contents. The police might try guessing some passwords, but Alice's password is just too obscure. Without Alice's help, they can't get at the hard drive. With Alice's help, though, they could trivially unlock the data. Now, Alice is concerned about being prosecuted, so she's not talking. This area of law is all about when the government can require Alice to help. Let me clear up a common misconception. In these cases, the government's formal demand is usually not for a person's password. That would be a straightforward instance of compelled, self-incriminating testimony protected by the Fifth Amendment privilege. I am not aware of a case where the government has successfully required a criminal suspect to hand over their own decryption key. And at least two courts have flatly rejected demands for passwords. The way these cases come up is a little more subtle. The government actually gives back the encrypted device, or a copy of the encrypted files, and it serves a demand for the decrypted files. Usually that demand takes the form of a subpoena duces tecum, though it can also be a writ collateral to a warrant. Alice would then decrypt the files and return the unencrypted data to the police. So, there's the procedure that law enforcement agencies have tried to use for compelled decryption. As for whether law enforcement agencies can use that procedure, the short answer is sometimes. I want to explain why that is in two parts. First, we'll explore the doctrinal structure for compelled decryption. Courts are in general agreement, at a high level, about how to think through the Fifth Amendment. Second, we'll look at how courts have applied this area of law. Courts don't agree on how to map the Fifth Amendment structure onto compelled decryption. Let's start with the doctrinal structure. The Fifth Amendment privilege protects against compelled, self-incriminating testimony. There's no doubt that compelled decryption is, well, compelled. And in these cases, there's also no disputing that the decryption could lead to incriminating evidence. So, these cases are all about whether compelled decryption constitutes testimony. The courts have held that the act of producing physical evidence can be testimonial if it requires a person to use the contents of their mind. The idea is that when a person hands over evidence, they could be implicitly disclosing that the evidence exists, that they have possession or control of the evidence, and that the evidence is authentic. The distinction between what's testimonial and what isn't is very slippery. The courts agree that handing over a physical key to a safe is not testimonial. And the courts also agree that entering the combination to a safe can be testimonial. The courts struggle mightily to analogize a case to one or the other of these two scenarios. It's a notoriously ambiguous doctrine. Moreover, even if handing over some evidence could be testimonial, there is an enormous exception to the doctrine. It's the foregone conclusion exception. It says that if the government already has a good hint at the evidence, then handing over the data is not testimonial. The idea is that if the government already knows about the evidence, then the testimonial aspects of production don't help the prosecution. The prosecution isn't learning anything new about the evidence's existence, who possesses or controls the evidence, or the evidence's authenticity. The Supreme Court has not provided much guidance in this area. There are just two major cases. In the first, Fisher against United States, the court held that tax documents prepared by accountants were a foregone conclusion. Prosecutors already knew that the documents existed. And through the accountants, prosecutors could already establish the documents' existence, ownership, and authenticity. In the second case, United States against Hubble, investigators went on a fishing expedition. They suspected that a person had incriminating business records, but they weren't sure. So they used a broad subpoena for a voluminous collection of general business records. The investigators were right, it turned out. A few of the records were incriminating. The Supreme Court held that the incriminating records weren't a foregone conclusion. The court emphasized that investigators had no prior knowledge of the existence or the location of the incriminating records. That was a lot of intricate legal material. So let's recap how courts determine whether compelled production is testimonial. First, they ask whether the production involves the contents of the mind, providing implicit testimony about the existence, possession, control, or authenticity of the incriminating evidence. In more concrete terms, courts ask whether the production is like opening a safe with a key or opening a safe with a combination. If a court finds that production would be testimonial, then it goes on to a second step. It asks whether the testimonial aspects of the production are a foregone conclusion. More concretely, the question is whether the government already has a good hint about the evidence's existence, location, and authenticity, like in Fisher, or whether the government is taking a shot in the dark, like in Hubble. All right, so there's the doctrinal structure for the Fifth Amendment privilege against producing evidence. Now let's work on applying that doctrine to compelled decryption. And let's start with the first question. Does compelled decryption involve contents of the mind? Yes. To my knowledge, no court has held otherwise. Judges have uniformly viewed compelled decryption as analogous to entering a combination into a safe. And that makes a lot of sense. A password is like a virtual combination. That brings us to the second question. Are the testimonial aspects of compelled decryption a foregone conclusion? In other words, did the government have a good hint at what was on the hard drive? Courts disagree on how much of a hint is required. There are, very roughly, two poles of opinion. At one end are courts that demand reasonable particularity from the government. Police need to already know details, like specific file names, before they can claim that decrypting the files would be a foregone conclusion. A circuit court and a district court have expressly adopted this view, and several other circuits have used the reasonable particularity phrasing in related contexts. I think it's fair to call this a majority view. In the competing view, at the other end, not much of a hint is required. Police might only need to know who owns the device, for example. Or maybe they need to know a little more, like what types of files are likely on the device. The highest court of Massachusetts has adopted this view, and arguably, so did one district court. Note that under this view, the Fifth Amendment doesn't provide much protection. If police are attempting to compel decryption, odds are very good they know who owns the device, and fairly good they know what types of files it contains. So, that's how courts have applied the Fifth Amendment privilege to compelled decryption. Since there was so much legalese in this lecture, let's do one more recap at a high level. Courts agree that the Fifth Amendment can prevent compelled decryption. Courts also agree that if the police have a hint about the encrypted data, then there is no Fifth Amendment protection. The place where courts greatly disagree is how much of a hint is required. Some courts demand specifics, while others seem so lax as to nearly eliminate the Fifth Amendment privilege. And that's the legal status of compelled decryption. In the next part of the course, we're going to discuss the law that applies in national security and foreign intelligence contexts. The statutory and constitutional protections are roughly parallel in structure, but they can substantially differ in substance with hugely important consequences.